Oh, look at them guns. All right, MAPS Performance is the program that we're giving away today. Great program for athletic performance, mobility. It also builds a very balanced body. So that's the free program. Here's how you can win. Leave a comment in the first 24 hours that we drop this episode. Subscribe to this channel and turn on notifications. You got to do all three of those things. If we pick your comment, we'll notify you and you'll get free access to MAPS Performance, one of our most popular MAPS workout programs. Also, before we get to the show, we have a huge promotion going on right now. MAPS Anabolic and the No BS Six Pack Formula combined together for only $59.99. That's it. That's less than the price of MAPS Anabolic by itself. So it's a huge promotion. If you're interested or you just want to sign up, head over to MAPSOctober.com. Again, that's MAPSOctober.com. All right, here comes the show.
Rock and roll.
Hey, are you guys seeing the calories in versus calories out like debate?
Oh, I'm glad you brought this up. I saw.
No. Is this a thing right now?
Why are they debating this?
I made a comment on Mark Bell's page. Mark posted a clip of Andrew Huberman. Am I saying
Huberman?
That right? Huberman. Yes. Am I saying that right?
Yeah.
Andrew Huberman, I think, was on a show, and I think Greg Duchette, I think is how you say the other guy's name. Came on there kind of talking shit, and then it caused like this. I mean, obviously Mark Bell was stirring the pot, trying to see who, and it was about he made a comment about calories in versus calories out is not the, you know, is less important, I guess, because I don't think he said that it's not important at all, but he said it's like it's not as important as everybody makes it out.
Well, so what's his angle? Is it more like food quality? Is he going in that direction?
Yeah.
There's more to the story than just the calories in and out.
But what's happening, I'm seeing on social media, is that people are saying things like calories in versus calories out, does it matter? Which is, okay, yes, of course it does.
Yeah.
But here's the reason why they say that is because they'll say things like, well, your hormones will affect how much fat you'll gain and how much fat you'll lose. Yes, because hormones affects the calories out, right? So if you take a man, let's say you get a man who has low testosterone, right? Clinically low testosterone, and you give him testosterone and he does nothing else, he will get leaner.
Yeah.
But it's not because calories out and calories in doesn't matter, but rather because the higher levels of testosterone has changed the calories out formula. It means they're burning more calories. Mm. The thing that people need to understand is this is a law of physics, right? So energy cannot be created nor destroyed, meaning I can't create extra tissue out of thin air. I need energy to do this. And I can't burn body fat or burn tissue if I have tons of available calories, unless my body's not going to do anything with those calories, which that's not what happens. So calories in, calories out, bottom line, that is extremely important. But what you eat, your activity levels, your stress level affects that formula from a calories out and calories in perspective. And then, of course, the thing that we talk about all the time are the psychological effects of your diet, right? So if I tell a client, and we used to do this all the time, I would tell a client, don't worry about how many calories you eat, just avoid heavily processed foods. And then they would be blown away that they would lose weight. But the reason why they lost weight is because they without realizing, they ate less because heavily processed
foods. It's sort of a trick. You ended up like reducing your calories and not even really realizing it.
Exactly.
I hate this conversation. I really do. It's really the two people that were debating in this situation, by the way, both are smart enough to know all of this. It's literally just taking something out of context, so it creates Instagram drama.
Yeah.
And now two people that are...
My nuance versus your nuance.
Yeah, exactly. Wow. It's just like neither one of those guys. I do not believe that Greg Duchette or Andrew Huberman do not recognize both that. It's just that something was taken out of context in, you know, and maybe Andrew said this like short line that said calories in versus calories out does not matter that much or something like that. And it's like, okay, well, what did he say before that? What did he say after that? Like, I know that guy is a very intelligent dude. I think he understands the law of thermodynamics plenty well.
Yeah.
You know,
and,
so.
And who loses this whole time?
Yeah. The consumer.
Everybody
that's why I fucking hate these conversations, because if you really care, like if you're you're in the fitness space and you started your Instagram, podcast, YouTube, whatever your platform was, with the intent of, I want to help people, I truly want to help people, then these conversations are fucking terrible.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because it does not help people. What it does, it confuses people and then divides us into camps. Oh, you're the camp that says calories in, calories out doesn't count. And you're the camp that says that that's all that matters. And then it's like, it's me versus you, when it's like, well, no, it's not really how it is. You know, yes, there's science to support, and that's true, but there's a lot of nuanced things that matter that people should also focus and think about, mm-hmm. maybe even focus on more. And I think that's the messaging really behind the smart group of people that are saying calories in versus calories out don't matter. I don't think they mean it doesn't matter at all. I think it's like, you guys are missing all these other things that are really important besides just focusing on your calories in versus calories out.
Well, there are people, believe it or not, there are people that say it doesn't matter. It's about managing insulin because insulin encourages fat storage. But the fat storage can't happen if your calories out is higher than your calories in. Right. It doesn't work. I've had this conversation with clients somebody I actually had a long time ago. I remember this was a terrible job on my part, but I had this lady to tears because she kept telling me, no, I'm gaining weight. This doesn't, and I knew she was lying on her nutrition. And I told her, I said, listen, if you're gaining body fat out of thin air, we need to take you to Stanford right now because you've broken the laws of physics. And this will be the greatest breakthrough of modern science. And she got really offended and she laughed. That was a really bad, coaching moment on my part. But, you know, like, here's another example, right? Building muscle. Why do studies show that building muscle is one of the most effective ways to be lean? Is it because the process of building muscle burns a lot of calories? No. The process of if you train to build muscle, you're going to burn less calories in that process than if you were doing cardio. Going for a run for an hour will burn more calories than any muscle building routine you'll do in an hour. That's a real muscle building routine. But why does the muscle building routine then work so effectively if it's all about calories in versus calories out? Because the process of building muscle, when you have that extra muscle, you start to permanently affect the calories outside of that equation, and your body just starts to burn more calories. That's why it works, not because we're circumventing this law of thermodynamics. But I agree with you, Adam. It's like, why are we confused? It's like the people who are like, you don't have to do barbell squats. Oh,
yes. Great example. Yeah. Another stupid argument.
Yeah. Okay. Stop. Like, who are you talking to? Like, because so many people are in fitness consumers and health consumers are watching this and they're just super confused. Well, I don't know. I read that it's about carbs. I read that it's about, you know, too much fat. And no, calories, that doesn't matter. Someone says it was about hormones. And meanwhile, people just gain body fat and get unhealthy and do the wrong stuff. Yeah. So we got to remember who we're talking to, or at least if you communicate this, always preface it. You know, always say, okay, everybody, what I'm about to say is nuanced. And then I'm going to explain it in that way so that the average consumer doesn't leave scratching their head going, all right, I give up.
Was that the post you're referring to, or is it a different one?
Well, it was. There's a lot of them going around right now.
I know. There's more than one. I know I saw another one too, but that was the one that jumped out at me that I saw. And I made the comment under there that, you know, Instagram is the new reality TV. Yeah. It's like you just do clickbait stuff to cause drama and arguments.
We just can't get past this whole tribal two-party system for everything.
It is.
That's just how I look at it.
It's how you sell, right?
Yeah, it's how you sell. You pit this person against this person. You know, there's no room for discussion between the nuance. It's like... I can't anymore.
Well, think about it this way. I'll use entertainment, right? When entertainment had a smaller bandwidth before the internet, if you made a movie, that was about the longest attention span you could get. There were miniseries on TV, but they weren't popular like movies. So a movie was like 2 hours long on average. You had to have a clear good guy and a clear bad guy. It wasn't until series where there's like 10 episodes, 15 episodes. It wasn't until that became popular where you could be really complex with your characters, where you had like a Tony Soprano who was, is he a good guy or is he a bad guy? Mm-hmm. I don't know. Like, because humans are complex, but we like to put things in categories where it's good, bad, easy. I know what to pick.
I know. Isn't that funny? And like you find people's heroes and, you know, and they idolize like even sports heroes, anybody like, but you could talk to one person who just loves them. But then the other person brings up some kind of dark past or some like, you know, thing that happened with them and their family. And you're just like, dude, humans are complex beings. There's good, but there's also not all the way good. Like
it's really how the brain operates, right? So that means
it has to categorize that way.
Exactly. It's either your brain has two speeds. It's either the fast or slow operating system that it decides. And fast is when it's in danger and it needs to get something really, really quick. But something logical and slow goes the other side. And so what we try to do is to fit it into a category really quick so people make quick decisions. It's just how evolution.
And you know what's funny is that nobody, by the way, is immune to this. So I, in fact, had an experience this weekend. We were driving with the kids and a song comes on. I don't remember the song. It was like an EDM song. And Ariana Grande is one of the voices on there. Now, she has an incredible voice, very powerful, incredible octaves. Reminds me of like Mariah Carey, like really, really good. But she is also a moron. Like, I cannot stand the stuff that she says.
You let him get away with that? I was like, nice today or what? What was that right there?
You know what? Aren't you happy though I continued? Because now,
I'm sorry. Keep going.
Listen, she's very talented as an artist.
Break it down, yeah.
But she's an idiot. And when she says stuff, and so what happens to me, because I recognize this, because I know some of the stupid stuff that she said, mm-hmm. when I hear a song, and
you
I know it's
don't
her,
like her,
I can't help but right? No. I was actually talking about this with my kids. I'm like, you know, it's really hard to just listen to the music and appreciate because I know this other stuff about her now. Which what does that change? It's still the same voice. It's still the same music.
Yeah.
It was super hilarious.
I mean, it's getting faster and faster. Look at the way like you have to market now. Like, you know, we're getting ready to do some stuff with like YouTube and things like that. And you have to think about the first like 3 seconds, the time that it takes someone to reach to fast forward your thing. You've got to say something or do something compelling enough to get them to go, oh, okay, let me listen. It's just getting crazier, man.
Man. I mean, it's the self-selection bias, right? It's like pulling somebody out of whatever they're looking at on their phone, their TV, everything is completely directed mm-hmm. towards their interests, and that's it. Yeah. So you don't get challenged ever anymore, and that's what we're dealing with people. Like they don't. If you get challenged, that means you're evil.
Yeah.
You know, like oh no, well that's evil stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, speaking of like challenging all that stuff. So have you guys? I'm sure you guys have heard of Squid Game by now. I brought it up on a previous episode. You guys made fun of me. It's viral.
Oh no, my oldest was like, "Dude, I want to watch Squid Game." I'm like, I don't know if it's appropriate for you.
No, it's not.
Okay,
it is not appropriate. For
I
her.
Tried to get into it. It's bad timing for me. I'm gonna try again because
you have to read.
Yeah, is that sort of? It was too much at nighttime.
It's a subtitle.
I'm like, oh no, I'm high.
Gives
I can't
you a headache.
I watch TV so I don't have to read. No, it's really good. You know those Korean movies, they put out some pretty twisted stuff, but I'm on like episode.
Is it like Parasite? You said that earlier.
So Parasite was good, but I hated the way it ended. It was so dark. It made me upset.
Oh yeah, it was so different. I think I liked it because it's so different.
Yeah, but Squid Game is very clever, very interesting. You do have to suspend a little bit of reality because you think like, why would this even? Hmm. But it's really good, and my son's been watching it, so all the kids are loving it apparently. Yeah. My daughter's in sixth grade.
It's getting a lot of
And she's
of attention.
Like, my friend said I should watch this. I'm like, excuse me? No, you should not be watching this movie.
Now, is it designed? Okay, so it's a series, right?
Yes.
And is it kind of like what I told you guys about what I'm noticing with, I don't know if I brought this up on air, but I know off air we talked about this. And you brought this up a long time ago about how media is changing. How, you know, just a decade or so ago, like you would never sit and listen or watch something for 3.5 hours like Joe Rogan on a podcast or like that. But we have this long form of media that's starting to happen. I even think that the future of movies are going to look really different. I think movies are going to become 8-hour movies.
Why not?
Yeah. And this clickbait was an example of that. It was like it literally was like a 8 to 10 hour movie.
Oh yeah. You kept telling us
that was done in like series. Mm-hmm. So I don't believe that there's a season two or another part that's coming to it. It felt like it ended, but it felt like it was this long, and it's really smart because if all they have to do is, you know, writers that are, I'm sure like working for Netflix are talented like this, where they write it in this way where like every hour is a cliffhanger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So then I feel like, oh my God, one more, I gotta watch one more. And then
I've noticed that. Yeah. With these series, even that Foundation, that new one on Apple, love it, by the way, so far. It's really good. But they totally had that hook, that, you know, that cliffhanger at the end, especially episode two. And we're just like, are you serious? Yeah. It's almost like what they figured out with Game of Thrones was, we're just going to totally spin you for a loop and you're going to have to come back to see what the hell, you know, we put together after that.
No, well, that's cool. No, but see, with Squid Game, because now, because the way media is now, I don't, that would have never reached the popularity that it has now. I mean, it's a Korean film. Subtitled, like, when would you, do you guys remember the last time?
And I think half of it is what I'm saying is that, okay, so what makes, like, clickbait, what makes Game of Thrones, well, actually Game of Thrones was separate, which, by the way, though, it was kind of hard to follow because it was a weekly thing. Like, partly why I think it's okay is because, and they can take so many turns and twists and it can have so many plots going at one time, is because you're like
binging it
one after another, like, yeah, that, where
you're consistent.
Yeah, in the past, when you have this week between episodes, sometimes it's really hard and you have to do like, what, I forget where we're at. And it happened to me watching Game of Thrones, by the way, because it was broken up by the week, like, where I had to wait. I'd be like,
oh, I know, like, I went back and watched and it was so much better when you, like, can watch them, like, back.
Yes,
to back to back.
Because there's so many, things. Yeah, there's so many things going on, but that fits really well for binge TV, right? Because you can just watch the whole thing and you're not going to lose track.
Well, you know, the writer, I think it was the writer or the creator of Squid Game, wrote it and for 10 years was turned down by every studio.
Oh, really? Wow.
So he's had that. He had that written.
How wild is that? Something that got turned down for that long.
And now it's
like
exploded.
a viral. Wow.
What a great story, though, right? Like, that's a great story to share with your kids when they're trying and trying and trying.
Especially, like, if it's something new. I think that's the really hard part, is if it's unproven. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of studios don't want to touch something that's not going to make them immediate box office money. And so to have anything original these days, really difficult to push through, but it's so appreciated when you actually see something.
Yeah, I love, of course, you know, I've been an entrepreneur pretty much my whole working career, and I love hearing stories like that, because that's, I think, the entrepreneur spirit, right? Is to just keep trying.
Yep.
Like Colonel Sanders, like, you guys have heard his story, right? How long he tried to get KFC created and got turned down. There's a lot of those stories of these entrepreneurs that just got hammered, and, you know, they're household names now.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it took Mr. Goodyear died poor, I believe.
His invention. You're right.
Tire. He died.
I don't want to do that. Yeah. I'm not trying to see it happen.
Like, a lifetime ability. And then, I mean, God, who doesn't know about Goodyear tires today? You know, how crazy is that?
Well, speaking of people like that, Tesla, obviously the company Tesla, named after, you know, Nikola Tesla, who later on, you know, didn't he die like broke and whatever,
right,
for his stuff. Speaking of Tesla and Elon Musk, you guys know how him and Jeff Bezos have a bit of a rivalry?
Oh yeah, it's all competitive.
Did you hear that? So I guess they always move one of, they always, like, one will be on top of the other in the rankings, and then the other one was in terms of being the world's richest man, right? So Musk, now world's richest man. So did you hear what he's doing?
Mm-mm.
He's sending a huge number two sculpture and a silver medal.
No, he's not.
Yes, he is.
No, he's
not.
Yeah,
he is, dude.
God, I like him, dude. Really?
Yes.
Is he really doing that?
Yeah.
I did not see this. God. Anyway.
See, that's how I would be.
I love that.
He's sending it to Bezos like, as a gift?
Yeah. Like, hey, congratulations. Bro, can I tell you something
right
now?
That's so funny.
If I was at that level and I got second place, I would appreciate the guy first place fucking with me like that.
Dude, you gotta have fun with it.
I would think it was so awesome. I'd be like, this motherfucker, I'm gonna get him back. You know what I mean? I'd do
no
something like that.
No way. I can't believe I didn't read this anymore.
Isn't that hilarious?
That's yes, really dude. Doug, you gotta pull me up an article. I wanna see this. I did not know that. Did that just come out recently?
Yeah, so.
Oh, that's so great.
I know. So I guess they have this rivalry, and obviously because the space race happened. And
so I didn't know that they had, like, obviously people who are writers and stuff like that, I think they try and write that, but do they actually truly have one themselves?
Yeah, look, that's his. That's literally Elon's, like, quote. I'm sending a giant statue of the Digital 2 to Jeffrey B. along with a silver medal. I like how he called him Jeffrey B. Hey, I'm team Musk.
Oh, dude, that's so funny.
Yeah, both obviously, you know, crazy and just crazy inventors, crazy entrepreneurs.
I saw something interesting.
Musk is my. I'm on his team.
There was there's a service out there I had never heard of before that actually will take your remains, so your ashes, and like rocket you into space.
Wow.
So just rockets your ashes and they'll just disperse them out there in space. So I was like, dude, that is what I'm doing.
That is
really
cool.
How you want to be alone in space?
Just
what if
you blast my dust out in the space, dude? I want to be panspermiate on top of another planet. Dude.
Hey, what if like an alien spacecraft picks up your DNA and then clones you, and then we get attacked by like a million Justins?
What the fuck? Where did they get this?
Dude, yeah. Oh my God. As long as it makes for some awesome science fiction novel.
I was
going
to say, there's a follow-up to your book right there.
100%. But I guess the creator of Star Trek was one of those, and that they had blasted out into space.
Oh, so was I right about that Foundation? Was it a Lucasfilms? It was done in Lucasfilms?
I think in terms of producing it.
Yeah.
I think you're right on that. Lucas might have, films might be a part of that in their studio.
Yeah, I thought
just
so.
Because the quality in it is really stellar so far. I'm like,
and they're using a lot of the same vocabulary, right? I feel like I thought I heard Empire and some of the other stuff.
I mean, Empire, they took, you know, that's just like because there's empires that already exist. Like
The way they used it, I felt like it was very Star Wars-esque.
Well, because you have Empire, you have Dawn, and then you have Dusk, I think is the other one. And it's interesting because they're like, it's this line of the same ruler, and so he just basically gets cloned and he grows up, he's like a little kid, and then he's the ruler currently, and then he's the old version of himself, and they all exist together, and then old guy dies, you know, the young one, you know, replaces the empire guy replaces, you know, the old guy. It's like this cyclical thing.
Can I tell you what annoys me about this? That I have to pay for another service to watch this.
Yeah, it is.
You know,
that's the unfortunate part.
Have you seen that article Jackie sent over about the average person on streaming? How funny is that?
Here's what's funny
that
about
is
this.
That's fucking funny.
Here's what's funny, because people are like, oh, I thought technology was going to make us save money. Okay, you got to compare apples to apples. We had 30 channels before. Yeah. It cost you nothing to have 30 channels now.
Well, you could, but again, we're greedy. Yeah, I want more
The
shows.
Average person spends $267 on streaming entertainment services.
But you know what? The irony of it is, I bet you 90% of the people that switched, you know, cut the cable, as they say, right, did it to save money.
Yeah.
Because it was back when streaming first started.
Yeah, because was it $150 for satellite usually?
Yeah,
it was around $100.
I was paying like $200 something for.
Yeah, I was the $200.
Xfinity, I actually reduced it substantially, but now I'm getting close.
I actually haven't gone and like tallied up all of them, and we could kind of do it quickly. I mean, I have Hulu, I have Netflix, I have HBO, I have Showtime, I have Epics, I have
ESPN.
You have all the things.
I have what they get you, it's like, oh, it's only $4.99 more. That's only $22.99. Like, I think I only pay for like one or two of them that are like 30 something and above. The rest are like $4.99 ads.
But isn't that for like the first 6 months? And then
So I think like my ESPN app, I want to say, is either $4.99 or $6.99 a month. My Epix, I think, is $9.90 a month. Same thing with HBO.
This is what I appreciate about my wife, right? Because she grew up without a lot of money, and so she's very frugal with that kind of stuff. So what she did is she's so funny. She's like, hey, honey, I signed up for there's this channel called Magnolia, and they do like home renovations and whatever. Pretty cool. She's like, I signed up for it, and I get a week for free trial. I'll be able to finish the whole series in a week, and then I'll cancel. I'm like, babe, you're turning me on right now. Tell me more about all this free stuff that you're getting. Yeah, totally. She totally did that too.
And they're brilliant because they know that they market, and there's always a percentage of people that will actually do it. But like the bulk of people will continue on and be more like an asshole like me and forget, and then months later,
I'm still here. So
speaking of service and all that stuff, did you guys see how many 5-star reviews Magic Spoon has already?
I saw Doug looking at that.
Over 20,000 5-star reviews for Magic Spoon.
Their average on reviews.
They haven't been around a whole long time.
No. Their average is over 4.8, which is funny because there's a couple people, just a couple people in our forum that I've seen put a negative comment about Magic Spoon. I always fucking go ballistic. I'm like, dude, how can you talk shit about that series?
It doesn't taste exactly like Frosted Flakes.
It's like, it doesn't have the other 40 chemicals that they're allowed to use to make like that for a healthy cereal
no
to taste
sugar
that amazing.
And protein in there? Come on, guy.
I'm truthful about every partner we work with, and I'll be the first one to admit when I think something's shitty. It sticks to your teeth. I mean, that's the
protein.
Yeah, it sticks to your teeth a little bit, and that can be like annoying. But when you know how healthy it is and how many grams of protein I'm getting in a serving, real easy to look past that.
Yeah, it's the one the one sponsor that I cannot use on a regular basis because I can't have dairy, which is
super
really,
FOMO over
you have, here. You know how frustrated I am about that? It's so annoying.
Yeah.
Luckily, we have other partners that I use everything that our partners send us. You know what I'm really liking a lot is the Paleo Valley bone broth. I can take.
I've seen you again this morning.
I can take so much of that protein and have zero negative effect.
Now, are you
on my
doing
gut.
That? Because I see you take that almost every day here now.
Oh, I'll take it three, 4 times a day because it's like water in terms of how it affects my gut. I can't do that even with plant protein sometimes if I push too hard.
And you just drink it straight, or are you like pouring it in like soups or like.
No, just in water. Yeah. There's nothing in there. It's literally bone broth. There's no flavor, no color, no nothing. It's just bone broth, protein. Oh, wow. And so I can jack my protein up and have...
I actually still have... I don't think I've even used their bone broth protein. I'm in love with their beef sticks.
My kids like the meat sticks.
The beef sticks are... I mean, if I mean, they
so
did...
so many good flavors.
I know you're talking about their protein and stuff like that, but I've had so many different healthy beef sticks, grass-fed beef sticks, and nothing compares to theirs.
No, I've had them all. Yeah. I've had them all because when I go to the grocery store on a road trip, that's always what I reach for at the gas station or whatever Whole Foods I'm. And none of them taste.
It doesn't even make sense how good it tastes because all the other grass-fed ones I have are all either tough or their flavor sucks, like nothing like that.
So hey, speaking of interesting companies, have you guys, I think I'm pronouncing this right, have you guys heard of the company, I think it's Joby, J-O-B-Y? Maybe Doug can look this up. Have you guys heard of this company?
No, so you can invest. Kids company?
No. So you can invest in this company on the market if you want. It's Joby Aviation. Okay. Hmm. Now now here's what's crazy, by the way. An analyst just gave it a huge rating because it's only $10 as of the recording of this. I think $10 a share. This is going to be a air taxi company. Check this out. This is gonna be an air taxi. Sick. It's very quiet. It's the only air taxi company that is FAA approved.
It's and, like a huge drone,
bro. And it's the only one that's signed with the FAA, I believe. Mm-hmm. They have, I think, over 1,000 test flights. So any other company that would want to compete with this would have to go through all that just to get there. So they're super like ahead of everybody. But this is like they're saying that this is potentially a realistic thing, that you'll literally be able to take
I could see that
an air taxi from San Francisco to LA and get there in like 2 hours instead of your normal 4 or 5 hours.
Now, is
it
just going to start by landing on like helicopter pads in terms of in the city or like how
I think
are they going to manage that?
I think that this, because of the way that how small it is, that you can land in, I think they'll have to have designated areas,
like
but
a
you don't need
parking lot or something.
You don't need like big spaces to land.
Yeah.
Dude, how wild is this?
So what's your, it's got to start off at like really expensive, right? Because there's no way that we could have as many Ubers running around in the sky like that, going to, like you just said, from here to San Francisco, right? Yeah. So a 45-minute car commute.
Manage the airspace too, like that's going to be like challenging as hell.
It doesn't fly very high, so I don't think it will get into normal airspace, but you're right.
But if it's competitive with, you know, eventually get a bunch in there.
Yeah, imagine 100 of them heading to San Francisco.
Now, here's the thing with the cost. Okay, let's just think of this, right? Imagine then they go through the process. There's a lot of regulations they have to go through, but so far they're doing pretty good. Now they get approval. Now they can operate, right? Mm-hmm. I would bet you so much money that they'd get so many investors to invest them and they would run in the red for like 5 years.
I want this to exist, dude. This looks awesome.
I bet you they would run in the red.
Imagine how much that would like start to relieve traffic on the road too.
Yeah.
So just being able to have that and as an option, you would think that would be.
Now, I do agree with you. I think it'll be more expensive than an Uber. However, I bet you they're going to want to run in the red for that. I bet you that's going to be part of their business plan. Like, we're not going to try and make any money for the first 5 years. So it'll probably be a lot cheaper than you think. And I bet you it'll be cheaper than a plane ticket.
Yeah.
Faster and cheaper.
Well, yeah, I assume you're not going to go as far as you would.
Like, yeah, I would imagine that it would be more used, like what you just said. Like, it'd be great.
More metropolitan.
I mean, coming like from San Jose to San Francisco, anytime, you know, between 6 a.m. and 9 a.m.
Yeah, take an hour and a half, 2 hours.
Yeah, that's a 2 hour commute because of traffic. And if you could hop on this, and on if it wasn't ridiculously priced, I would do it all the time. I would do that instead. I would never drive to that.
Now, I wonder then if you get your pilot's license or whatever, if you could have like a private one yourself.
Well, so it's ride sharing. So I think that's it. I think what they're going to have is people who have their licenses,
yeah,
who are going to be contracting.
Oh, interesting.
How sick.
Yeah.
Dude, that's going to open up a whole...
I think that's what
it's going to be. So Joby is a... I've never even heard of this company. How do they even get the capital to build something?
Well, so the reason why I know about this is, so you guys know how my cousins and my... I have a group. I have a text group with my cousins and a couple friends, and they're all investment people. I'm like the only one in my family that isn't into investments. I got into fitness, right? I wanted the big money.
Yeah.
But anyway, but they sent this to me into the group because an analyst just gave it a much higher rating because it's only $10 a share. It's still risky, but I read the article and I kind of looked into it. And I'm like, oh shit, this might be crazy.
Super cool.
But this opens up a whole nother world of weirdness. Like, I don't know. Like, you could be. Like, people going to smuggle things into other places? Like, what's the deal with, you know? This could open up a whole new can of worms.
I see a company like Uber buying a company like this.
So
right?
do I.
Let them get the technology up and running, prove it, get all the stuff they need to.
Absolutely.
And then like the big company comes in and buys
absolutely.
Them. Like they're too small, as far as I know, small of a company for them to actually be the
one. Now here's the one downside, right? If an Uber crashes, nobody cares. Nobody reads about it. Yeah. Ubers crash all the time.
Dude, these
right?
things could crash and fall in your house.
Yeah. Well, if one of these crashes, it's big news and no one's going to want to take one. Just one, right? One crash. Oh my God, you know, new flying taxi crashed, killed two people. Pfft, nobody's going to want to take them anymore.
I mean, you said they've done 1,000 flights, right? Is that what you said already?
Test flights, yeah.
So, I mean, that's a lot.
And it's pure, it's 100% electric. So there's no emissions, supposed to be good for the environment. Wow. All that stuff.
Probably doesn't make a whole lot of sound.
Well,
because that would be another issue.
No, they made him quiet. Here's the other thing, right? So right now there's a pilot. If this gets approved and it starts working, it's only a matter of time before they become automatic or, you know, self-driving.
Right.
Think about how this would change the landscape in terms of where people buy their homes, where people live. All of a sudden, all these
super remote, and then you just like fly into office.
Well, look, okay, we live in the Bay Area. We live in like, you know, the San Jose area. If you go over the hill to the Santa Cruz area, there's some gorgeous places to live there. One of the reasons why a lot of people don't buy there is because there's one freeway basically to get there, and
super
people
congested.
And people on that side of the hill like that because they don't want a bunch of people moving over there.
Yeah.
That'll change. All of a sudden, I'm like, shit, I'll live near the over there because it's easy for me to take this flying taxi or whatever.
God, what we don't want your kind.
Yeah.
less than 10 years? What do you think?
Flying? No. I think, well, yes. With pilots, yes. I think less than 10 years.
And you think we're going to see automated cars before the flying?
I do.
You'll go, you think so?
Yeah, I do.
Oh, see.
There's so much more red tape for flying than there is for.
You know what, though? But I feel like it would be, there'd be an easier transition.
More demand.
I feel like there'd be an easier transition because there's not a bunch of competition in the air. Whereas you're gonna have this huge.
But you still have a human
cars.
Piloting it.
Yeah, you're gonna have when we decide to go to.
There's already self-driving cars. Doesn't Pizza Hut or one of those pizza places already have a automated delivery car?
Yeah, they do. They did roll that out.
It's already happening.
Yeah, well, kind of, right? I mean, you have like
it's pizzas.
It's like a little pizza go-kart.
We're going to have
like
dishwashing robots and stuff like that.
Got to go there.
Anyway, hilarious. You guys want to hear some ridiculous news?
Yeah.
How come whenever there's like somebody did something bad to their genitals, it's always a dude?
Oh, what? Yeah.
Every time I read an article about something like that, it's always a person. So you ready for this?
Every time.
So there's a case report of a man who got his penis stuck inside a plastic bottle. You ready for this? For 2 months.
Two months?
2 months.
He just didn't want to go to the doctor and explain his story.
Did not go to the doctor. And then, of course, it got swollen and all that stuff. And
Wait. So he was stuck in it, but was he able to pee and what?
Yeah, that doesn't make sense.
I have no idea.
Oh, maybe he cut a hole at the other end.
Yeah, that's what I mean. They cut part of the hole off, but didn't
want
to keep
going. What kind of bottle are we talking about here? Like a wide mouth bottle or like a little Coca-Cola?
Adam wants to know how big his hog is.
I could fit it in there.
I'm trying to get a mental picture, Sal. Was it a wide mouth bottle? No, but
Snapple bottle?
It's funny because every time, it's funny, there was like a few episodes ago, right? There was like a couple articles that were like this. So now people are sending me articles of, and it's always a man. I never read an article about a woman doing something crazy to herself. It's always a dude gets something stuck up his butt.
Same thing. Yeah, I was going to say in the ER, like I remember talking to some surgeons and they're just always like telling hilarious stories about how people slipped and fell and landed on, you know, like a Hot Wheels car.
Yeah, that's weird.
Well, men are just less risk adverse. You know what I'm saying? Like we're willing to take those crazy.
How you make it sound like a good thing.
Yeah.
We're just innovators.
Yeah.
That's the reason.
Somebody had to figure out if you could actually put it in a bottle or not. Now we know. Yeah. You can't do that.
Yeah, look at that. This Doug brought up an article talking about it. He called it a masturbation game. Did he win? I don't know. What was the goal of the game?
The man started to rot after he got it stuck in the...
I didn't get that part. Well, I mean, I guess it would, right? You cut it off that long.
Circulation. Yeah.
45-year-old. Where's he at?
He's Nepal. A 45-year-old man. Where?
In Nepal.
Oh. Okay.
Where's that at?
Nepal?
Yeah.
It's
over north of India.
Yeah, thanks, Doug.
Doug knows
Nepalese
random people. Stuff, yeah.
He just knows the world very well.
The Himalayas, right? Near that.
Yeah. He's traveled the most, I would say, right, Doug? You've probably traveled the most.
Probably true.
How many countries have you been to?
Maybe 30.
Really?
Yeah.
You might meet Jessica. She's been to a lot because she traveled with Cirque. So you might actually have her beat her.
30 countries? Huh?
Yeah.
What's the weirdest place you've ever been to?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
And define weird for us.
I don't know. I mean, I've been to some third world countries.
Have you really?
Yeah.
Have you been to India?
No. I've been to like Cambodia. And
okay. Least favorite.
The least favorite country. Yeah.
Like which one did you like, I'll never go back there again?
That's a good question.
It's all California.
Yeah. The United States.
No.
Boy, that's a good question. I really don't know the answer to that.
No? I've 30 countries? You can't think of one that was shitty?
Come on, Doug. Doug is super positive.
Yeah, he's all positive.
Bus. Yeah, I mean, I found something interesting anywhere I've gone. You know, the countries I'm least interested in traveling to oftentimes are the more modern ones.
Like the common ones.
The ones
that people travel to all the time.
Yeah, I like more variety, like different cultures, different languages, you know, unusual things. So Adam likes, you know, nice hotels.
Nice mattresses.
People who speak English. Yeah. I'm quite the opposite at times, even though I can enjoy
nice
that
mattress,
as well.
Good dining.
Fluffy pillows.
So I'm like,
servants.
I was like
massage
Adam.
Massage therapist that comes to your room.
I was very much like Adam until I got convinced by my wife to go to Thailand and to go to one of those like off islands or whatever in Thailand. And Thailand's not even that crazy, but to me it was. And I'm like, all right, I'll do it. What happens? I get the worst food poisoning in my entire life, and I had 140.
That's what you get for not sticking with my theory.
I'm like, babe, I told you we should have gone to freaking Maui. Yeah. I would have been fine.
Yeah, you'd be safe there.
I wouldn't almost die.
Lava flows.
Yeah, anyway. You know, I guess I would have to go with the right person with the right mindset to enjoy that stuff. Like I hated Peru, and some people love Peru. I hate it because I didn't know that it was like a third world country where we were at, and it was extremely poor. Food was amazing.
I heard they have really good food.
Yeah, the food was really, really good. But then there just wasn't much to do.
I had a buddy that the way he liked to travel was he would literally buy a ticket to go somewhere like that. Like he'd go to Peru or he'd go to Cambodia with no plans.
Yeah.
He would land.
I know people that do that.
He'd get off the plane and then he would just talk to people. And one time he got off and he got this guy to give him a ride to a village. He ended up staying at the village the whole time. And
what do you call those companies that they're really popular now? I forget what they're called, but you basically fill out a profile. And you tell them, like, this is my budget.
I heard about this.
These are things.
You just show up and they send you
whatever
they want.
Yes, you don't know. You find out, like, the morning of where you're going.
Right.
Like, they keep it, like, a complete surprise the entire
time.
They
call it Squid Game, I think.
No.
I'm just kidding.
I don't know if there's an actual name for those companies, but they've been getting more and more popular.
Now, you know what's brilliant about that business model? Is that these companies get all your information and then they you probably already pay.
Yeah.
So they probably charge you and they go,
they just
all
right. Find cheap flights. What,
yeah.
Like, you
what's,
know,
the,
some
what's the least expensive thing that
exotic.
Fits the criteria that we could totally do? We have till the last day.
No, I think it doesn't work that way. And I think they ask you like that too. Like as far as like, I mean, you have to put your budget in there that you want to be in. And if you want, you know, third world country type of thing, find more culture stuff, or do you want to be pampered? Like those are all part of the questionnaire. For them to decide kind of where you go. And are you looking it up right now, Doug?
Yeah, pack up and go.
Yeah, that's it. That's one of them. I've heard of that one.
Yeah, I was, who was I talking to? I was talking to someone about raising your kids and, you know, raising them where they're privileged, right? They have everything they want, everything they need. They go to good schools. And the conversation was like, how do I give them adversity? Because what I'm afraid of is that they go out into the real world and they're somewhat spoiled. Mm-hmm. And you know, like my kids, my son is in a junior in high school. He's never seen a fist fight in real life in his entire life. Never. By the time I was a junior, I'd probably seen 100 and I'd been in half of them myself. And now, is that a good thing? Not necessarily, but the challenge of it, I think you learn from that kind of stuff. Because what's going to happen as an adult when he's out and something happens in front of him, is he going to even know how to handle himself, right? So I was talking to this friend of mine, and they said, what studies show, having your kids volunteer and go overseas to places like, you know, third world countries where they're building houses or whatever, and it teaches them perspective. Mm-hmm. They see like a new world in front of them and go, okay, things are very different in other places.
Isn't that what Habitat for Humanity is? Isn't that, aren't they, don't they do
I'm
that?
I'm not familiar, but.
Really?
No.
Oh.
Yeah, they build houses in third world countries.
That's what they do though. And mm-hmm. you can volunteer to do that, right?
Right.
Yeah, it's kind of like the secular version of like a church mission, right? Because mm-hmm. church mission, all churches I know do that.
They
too.
Do that.
Yeah.
Did like you guys mission. Ever do anything like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we did a Mexico trip one time. I feel like we've done that a few
really?
Times. Yeah.
And
yeah.
you went and built stuff?
Yeah, yeah. That's and I think it's incredible. I think I was already poor enough though. I didn't need to go fucking somewhere poor. I mean, personally for me,
the church came to your house.
Yeah,
right.
yeah.
Actually, I'm gonna stay.
I did not grow up like your son. Like I'd seen plenty of fist fights. I've seen plenty of electricity out. I've seen plenty of that. You know, but you know what my parents did? Like, see, there's a lot worse out here. That's what that was for me. That's how my parents did it.
At least you have electricity.
Yeah, exactly. See, look, they're not even eating. You got food yesterday. You know what I'm saying? So, oh wow. Okay, I get it. We are privileged. That was I think that was the message.
Where did you go, Justin?
Yeah, we went down to Mexico, Haiti. Mexico, it was interesting because we stayed at this place, and then like right next to us was this like trench, like this canal. And you know, in the middle of the day, when you know the sun started to come up and like everything started to heat up, you found out that like that's where all the sewage was. Oh. And so it was just like, oh, it was coming in, and that was like the wake up call was like, you know, like so it was gnarly.
Yeah,
it was a gnarly thing. But we built like two houses there. And so I was on the team that was like part of that. So wow.
Yeah, cool. For me, I never did anything like that. But because I'm one step removed from my parents that are immigrants, you know, that I would hear stories. And when I would go visit, I remember my grandmother's house was like hundreds of years old. And I remember talking to my grandfather and he's like, oh yeah, when, you know, he was explaining his living situation. And when he was a kid, they lived in one, it was one room, but it was like cement, right? So one room. And it was him and his seven siblings, his mom and his dad, and the donkey. The donkey, they'd bring him inside and they'd put a sheet between the, that's how they broke up the rooms. And he's explaining to me, like, I'm like, you know, what about bathrooms? He laughs, like, bathrooms? We had to go outside over here. And when I was, you know, 12, I would go leave for 4 days and find ways to make money to bring back. So the stories would help me, you know, kind of put things in perspective. But
yeah.
My kids have no, I mean, my stories to my kids are like dumb. Like, hey, when
so
I was
is your
kid,
son
going to
do something like that? Do you have plans for him to do something like that?
Yeah, I think I want to, their his senior year, I think I'd like to send him somewhere.
It's a good idea.
To I do think. Something like yeah. that. Yeah, kind of.
Just give him more perspective.
Yeah, have him get in a fist fight or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. It's just, you gotta do it
some
once,
kid to bully
dude.
Him.
Fight club.
Drive up to some hard looking kid, yell something out the window, push him out the car.
Yeah.
You'll
good
learn.
Luck, son.
Yeah. Pick him up later. Yeah.
Oh, there's something to be said though about that. I tell you, like you see enough fights at school, you go like, man, you just can't say anything. I feel like the generation now feels like you could just mouth off and say whatever online and
oh,
shit.
Oh my god. Yeah.
Like the stuff you see people say and do like on
oh in real life,
it's
that
upsetting
been,
to me. Yeah.
Yeah.
People aren't
like
getting
you can't
hit
do
face.
That. You can't do yeah. that in real life. Real life, you like, don't know if that other dude's crazy. No. You know what I'm saying? He's not playing with a full deck. He could
face,
potentially hit you with a bat upside yeah. the head.
Also, I think you learn how to read a room or read energy. Like, I think when you're around a lot of that, you know, you could be at a bar or somewhere and you could tell, we need to go. I could tell that there's, you know, some stuff happening yeah. or is going to happen soon, which I think is an, you know, very important skill. Hey, real quick, I hope you're enjoying the show. Look, if you want to learn more about how to build muscle, burn body fat, improve your health, head over to mindpumpfree.com. We have a lot of free giveaways that can help you get the body that you want and get the health that you want and the performance that you want. Again, it's mindpumpfree.com. All right, enjoy the rest of the show.
Our first caller is Josh from California.
What's up, Josh? How can we help you?
Oh, hey, guys. Thanks for having me. Shout out to Jerry for coordinating.
Jerry.
My question's all around adjusting calories and training while working through an elimination diet. A bit of background. regular lifter for about 10 years now. The entire time until about 2019, I was a 60 to 80 mile a week runner, as well as 7 days a week in the gym. 2007 to 2017, I was also a daily smoker. So throw that in there. The last 12, 18 months, training much more of a bodybuilding style, high reps, low rest periods, chasing the burn, chasing the pump, using a mix of split and aesthetic. I moved in June, made the switch over to powerlift shortly after that. Been way too long in that high rep phase, jumping down to lower rep. I'm actually starting week four of phase two right now. Been eating fairly consistently around maintenance, 2,000, 2,500 calories a day. And then for the last year, I've also been dealing with a lot of like gut issues, inflammation, bloating, discomfort. Finally hit a breaking point. I reached out to a friend of mine who's a DO, running a lot of tests, did some blood work, did some food insensitivity and intolerance testing. Also did some heavy metal testing based on the history of smoking and the high levels of heavy metals in the water where I used to live. So the first thing she's having me doing is work through an elimination diet. I already eat a diet very heavy in whole foods, lots of fruits and vegetables, lots of animal protein, little to no processed foods, no sugary drinks, water and coffee is pretty much it. So taking all that into consideration, what would you suggest as far as adjusting calories and adjusting training while working through an elimination diet? So I set myself up for the best possible avenue to success.
Yeah, no, thanks for calling in. And you, by the way, you know, for people watching, you know, Josh also sent his question in that, and I looked at ahead and read some of the stuff. There's some details you didn't explain here, and I think they're important. You're also finishing up an MBA at the moment.
Oh, yeah. So I work 50 to 60 hours a week, my full-time job. 3 days of those, 3 days a week, I commute an hour and a half one way. So those 3 days, I really just try to move a little bit, some mobility work, corrective work. The 4 days I'm home are the days that are my foundational days. And I also spend my weekends and kind of downtime working on my MBA program, wrapping that up. It's one course right now, so it's not a whole lot of work, but it definitely adds to very high level of admittedly self-induced stress that I carry.
Yeah. You also commented that you've got brain fog and that your energy's kind of low and you're noticing it's getting worse and worse. Question, have you gone through SIBO testing just through for the gut stuff just to get out of that out of the way?
I have not yet. No. Okay.
I would get tested for SIBO. Always see if you can rule that out, only because it's relatively treatable and it can cause lots of the gut issues that you're experiencing. But here's what really becomes evident to me right away. Just looking at your question, hearing you explain your past and what you're currently doing, you're doing too much. The inflammation that you're noticing in your gut could also be caused by the fact that you're just chronically overtrained and just chronically, and that combined with the brain fog and the lack of energy. Now, if you do have SIBO, you could treat that. Typically, antibiotics will do it. There's even herbal antimicrobials that have been shown in studies to be just as effective. They just take a little longer. But if that's being ruled out, let's get you get tested for SIBO, you don't have it, or you do have it, and then you solve it, but then you still have these issues. And even if you didn't have those issues, can you hear me?
There it is. Yeah. Yep, you're back.
Even if they can't, even if you know, you solve it and you still have these issues, whatever, you're doing too much, man. This is a lot of training. You're doing, you know, power lift, plus you're running, plus you're trying to complete an MBA. You're working like crazy. Those drives, all the things that you're telling me, your symptoms scream too much. You're just doing way too much. So, and this is tough because, especially for those of us that have been working out for a while, you know, we know what our body's done in the past and, you know, we can kind of skate by on this much volume and training and we think that's not the issue. But you would be surprised just how incredible the body responds sometimes when you go from doing too much to doing the right amount. And I would go by cutting your training volume way down, especially with the amount of, you know, work that you're doing and the stress that you're under. MAPS Powerlift's already a decent amount of volume. It's a competitive program. Plus the run, it's just too much, and you need to cut that down.
Well, not even, he didn't even ask that. He was asking a question related to calories and stuff too, which I would actually suggest if you're doing an elimination diet right now, you're not concerned really about eating in a surplus or a deficit. It's more about when you're hungry, feed your body, make whole food choices, stay within the parameters of the elimination diet. Don't add any more restrictions to that. I mean, you've already got enough on your plate. Really, the idea of the elimination diet is to look for these foods that could be causing inflammation or any other issues going on in your gut. So there's no real reason for you to now be trying to eat in some sort of a calorie surplus to gain or build. It would really be eat to be satisfied. And then you also don't want to be in any sort of a dramatic cut or reduction, because that could be the reason why you feel so good, is because you're low calorie so much and you're not hitting your calorie intake. So I would eat when you're hungry and feed your body when it tells you to. Just stay within those parameters in regards to talking about your nutrition question. And then I agree with Sal. You've got a ton of stuff on your plate right now that someone like you, I would prefer if you were a client of mine, you were running something like MAPS Anabolic. I think that program is more conducive to the type of a schedule that you have right now. And if you wanted to put some mobility work in there on trigger days, I think that would be fine, but that's more recuperative than it is getting after it.
Yeah, I mean, you said, you know, in your question, you're saying you've been consistent for 10 plus years and used to run tons and tons of miles. Would people who know you well, like your wife or your girlfriend or friends that have known you for a long time, if I were to ask them, do you think Josh is a fitness fanatic or overdoes it? What do you think they would say?
They absolutely would. Yeah. In fact, it was my brother that really convinced me to ditch the bodybuilding 6-7 days a week training and drop down to 3 or 4.
Yeah, yeah. So here's the problem or the challenge with people. And I'm like you, Josh, exactly like you. I love exercise so much, especially the mental and psychological aspects. I want to do it all the time. The challenge is, whenever something is wrong, what we tend to do is we tend to look everywhere else. So rather than like cutting my workout days down, like, well, maybe it's my diet. Maybe I need this supplement. Maybe I need to do this thing with, you know, for my gut health, or maybe I need to do this thing with my sleep. And I look at everything else besides the obvious thing that's in front of me, because God forbid, you know, I have to exercise any less. But just from reading your question and hearing what you're asking, that is like glaring. And I can say this because it's not me I'm talking about. I was talking about someone else. I'm talking about you. And to me, it seems very obvious too much stress on your body, way too much stress.
So you're doing all these things and you're doing an elimination diet at the same time?
What does that look like? Trying to tease out the elimination diet. Cutting out all cheeses, cutting out all gluten products, all dairy, basically all the fun foods.
Have you stripped it down to like one thing and then kind of built, you know, reintroduced it back from there? Or are you kind of like just taking out an offender, you know, one by one?
Just starting it. I hadn't planned that far ahead yet. I was probably going to do just taking one thing out at a time. So I'm not taking everything out and then not sure what it is causing the issue, but trying to tease out one individual thing or a couple of things that are causing problems.
Yeah. I just know that's a tough thing to compile all those things on top of, you know, just to be able to focus on that alone. It, you know, takes a lot of discipline, and to be able to run it long enough for you to really even know the difference when you reintroduce these types of foods to be able to pay attention to that. So I would, you know, if that's your goal, I would center most your goal around that first, identify, you know, what's really going on and go through the other protocol for SIBO and all those types of things, and then kind of get back and build on, you know, the training side a little bit more exclusively.
I would love to see like a MAPS Anabolic with a carnivore-esque type of diet. So carnivore diet with maybe a few things that you know aren't going to be a problem, like maybe rice and maybe certain vegetables that you know that are well cooked. Like I'd do that, something like that diet-wise, eat when I'm hungry, stay fed, and then running something like a MAPS Anabolic. That's the direction
I would go. Yeah, I follow the guidance of the person you're working with who's an expert on nutrition. Ask them about SIBO testing. But with the workout, I would 100% back what Adam's saying. In fact, I would do the 2 foundational workouts a week, MAPS Anabolic, not the 3. I would go for you,
okay,
2 foundational workouts a week. That's it. Full body lifting. You can do your run. That's fine. Keep your run. So now you're working out 3 days a week. On any other day you want to be active, mobility or yoga or stretching, stuff like that. All kind of recovery-based type of stuff.
Good walks.
And don't be surprised, Josh, if you do this and you get stronger within 2 weeks. Okay, so that's a good sign. If you do this, you back out, and within 2 or 3 weeks, you're like, oh my gosh, I feel so much stronger in the gym. You know that you're on the right track. But I would do that to begin with. You're just, there's so much being thrown at your body, and it's kind of, it's sending you a lot of signals saying that you're doing too much. Don't keep going and don't wait for a louder signal, because louder signals are coming if I'm indeed right, and I think I am. So I would go. And do you have MAPS Anabolic, by the way?
I do, actually. Yeah.
All right. Let's go that
first one I got.
Let's go that route. Two foundational workouts a week with your run, and then if you're not in our forum, we'll let you in the private forum. I'd like to just, I'd love for you to give us some updates on how everything's going.
No, I am actually
perfect. I knew I recognized your
legitimately,
name.
Like I wasn't calling to get anything. I've got all the programs. I'm in the forum. Been around for a while.
I knew I recognized your name, Josh. I've seen you in the forum. Yeah. So yeah, when I saw your name, okay, cool, perfect. Give us some updates of what's going on within 2 to 4 weeks of following this protocol. You should start to notice some improvements, at least in how you feel.
I will. And if you'll allow me, I got to shout out my brother real quick.
No problem.
He was on a live Q&A in February with you guys. Didn't shout me out, and little turd, I'm the one that got him into my computer first. Just wanted to give him a quick shout out. Hey, Spencer.
All right. No problem. Thanks for calling in, Josh.
Thanks, Josh.
Thanks, guys. Hey, y'all have a good day now.
You too. All right.
Yeah, that's the challenge. It's like, I'll do everything but work out less, you know? And I know I identify with that. I know exactly what that feels like. I just recently cut my training down from 6 days a week, which I've done forever, down to 5. And voila, the inflammation I had in my joints started to go away. But it's like, you don't want to kind of face that. But especially with everything he's doing with the work and the,
He's just fighting so much stress internally. It's like you got to start really like shaving some of that back. And I know it's tough to do when you're so, you get so much benefit from moving around all the time and like having a consistent routine. And, to tell somebody that's always a challenge.
Well, it seems so counterintuitive when you think about it. I mean, you think exercise, you think healthy. So when people think like, oh, I'm not feeling good, I got issues. Oh, exercise more, do more, it'll help me out. But yeah, when I saw the list of all the things he's got going on, I'm like, oh man. And then on top of that,
body a break.
To do a to run a quote unquote diet is not ideal at a situation like this too. Like if you're severely overtraining, you got high levels of stress, and then you're thinking about either calorie restricting or major surplus of calories, just not ideal. Eat when you're hungry and satisfied. I love the idea of an elimination diet, but not doing it with the intent of trying to lose weight or gain weight.
Yeah, but as far as the health is concerned, if people only realize that chronic overtraining is almost as bad for you as not working out. I mean, you look at the studies on people who are chronic, that high level athletes, like endurance runners, their lifespans are not very good because chronic overtraining, that oxidative stress on the body, not allowing your body to adapt to it. It's like getting out in the sun and getting too much sunburn. You don't let your body get a tan, you burn your skin. What do you end up with, right? Cancer. So you got to train appropriately, and that's a lesson I also have to constantly teach myself, but it's easier to see in other people.
Our next caller is Dalton from California.
Hey, what's up, Dalton? How can we help you?
Hey, what's up, guys? Good to talk to you. I had a couple questions about the MAPS Performance program. To give you a little background, I've been lifting for a long time. And then I recently started following you guys, followed Anabolic, and got a lot of gains from that. Lagging body parts caught up, and now I'm doing MAPS Performance. I'm also doing the pre-prime and post-prime. And then we asked the cool thing. Sorry, guys, I'm on the road. So we stopped at Starbucks to talk to you. and I'm also doing the fortification sessions for Zone 1 and Zone 2. And I'm also on top of that trying to do no BS six pack and practicing pull ups, flat bench, and squats. But my question basically is for MAPS Performance, when the program doesn't specify each side for single arm or unilateral movements, should I be doing the given rep range like for both, or should I be doing like that total amount of reps?
Okay, good question. People ask this all the time.
Yep.
So you can do, you're supposed to do this, those amount of reps per side. Now, when I look at the question that you wrote in, one of the things that you had said also was it felt like it might be too much for you, or feel like you're kind of overdoing it a little bit. Is that correct?
Sometimes it seems like it takes a long time or is a lot. So I was just wondering if I was doing it right.
Yeah, you are. If you're doing those, you want to do the total reps, is that's per side. Now, how's your progress? Because you're doing a lot of stuff all at once, and that feels like most people would be overtraining.
Sometimes it feels like I am, especially when I get a little excited when I'm practicing and I do a little too much. And sometimes I come into my foundational days sore. So then I have to pull back a little bit. But that's about it. Otherwise, I feel really good.
Okay, if you feel really good, then you're doing okay. If you see yourself performing and your performance improving, then you're doing pretty good. But definitely listen to your body. And this is just this is for anybody who's listening. We write these programs as guidelines. They're not hard and fast rules. At the end of the day, you got to listen to your body. Because if I trained a client with MAPS performance, I would modify it according to the person and how their body responded. So if something feels like too much, it probably is, especially someone like you. You sound like you've worked out for a little while and you're pretty consistent. You don't sound like somebody who's always looking for a reason to do less. It sounds like you might be someone who might err on the side of more, in which case I'd say listen to your body. If you feel like you're doing too much, you probably are.
Yeah, and just to kind of clarify, just so everybody can hear like what our thought process was with a higher amount of reps and like sort of the volume being up high in that like zone or phase two, for instance, we're trying to introduce a lot of like brand new movements to people, and so to be able to practice these movements, we wanted to make sure that you had the opportunity to basically get a lot of practice with that. And so a lot of people have realized that that is a substantial amount of volume for something you might not be familiar with, whereas somebody that's familiar lunging quite a bit, it's a piece of cake for them. So I've gotten both sort of comments in regard to the amount of reps and what that's entailed. But honestly, we try to prescribe it so it's a way for you to really adapt and to be able to respond appropriately to multi planes and establish that strength.
Well, it's a way for us to force clients to lighten the load. Right. So we knew by doing like, and it's normally the one that I think everybody is always asking about is the lunge matrix.
Yeah.
The lunge matrix is the one that everybody's like, holy shit, that's so many reps per side. Are you sure this is written correct? And so we get that a lot. But is this, because to me, it sounds like that was just kind of your main question was, am I doing it correctly? I think you are. You're fine. I don't know if you were asking what Sal was kind of alluding to, which is, maybe too much training volume. I think it was just, am I doing the program right? Is there another question that you have in regards to what you're doing right now? Because it seems like that was a pretty basic question.
I guess I was just wondering if I was doing too much and if I was programming correctly, because I've really bought in and tried to follow your programs as much as accurately as I can. And I've seen good results from that.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I think Sal said it, where if you're seeing progress, like if your pull-ups are getting better, your flat bench is getting better, you feel like you're getting stronger, that's such a great indicator that you're probably not overdoing it. You're just fine. I think that the fact that you're already aware that some days you come into foundational days, you're a little sore, and so you adjust and back off. I mean, I think that's great. I think that you get the concept and you understand that that's not a good thing to come in super sore every foundational workout. But let me tell you, that's inevitable. I don't care how many programs I've written, how long I've been doing this for, I still overreach and have those workouts where I go, damn it, I did more than I needed to. Next time I'll back off a little bit. And you just get better and better at that the more you practice. And the fact that you're aware of that and you're paying attention to that, it sounds like you're on the right track, man.
Okay, sounds good. My other question was, I was wondering if it's okay to take a day off to like test strength gains and lift heavy, or would you recommend doing that at the end of the program?
I mean, if it's really important to you to see how strong you are, you could do that. It's not that big of a deal. I think the people who should do that are people who are competing in strength type sports where they need to know kind of what their limits are so they could train in terms of percentages. But honestly, it's not that important. Now, if it's something you really enjoy and you really want to do it, then yeah, I would take some time off for testing, those maxes. But ideally, you'd want to wait till the end.
Okay, sounds great. All right, then I was wondering if you had any recommendations for me to move forward. And during anabolic, I missed a week because I was sick. And then 2 weeks later on, because I was in Kauai, during that time I did MAPS suspension. So I was wondering if I should go back to anabolic or I was considering going to something like powerlift or aesthetic.
The best route with the order of the programs is MAPS anabolic, MAPS performance, and then MAPS aesthetic. So if you've already done MAPS anabolic, you're finishing MAPS performance, go into MAPS aesthetic.
And then powerlift would follow that.
Powerlift would be good after that, or strong would be good after that. We wrote the first three. Those are like the base foundational programs, and we wrote them specifically to be followed that way. That would be like an ideal way to follow those. So I would go aesthetic if you're kind of trying to figure out what to follow next.
All right. Sounds great. Yeah.
All right, man.
My wife and I have been following your programs and we love it.
Excellent.
And I've found more consistency and enjoyment out of my programming and working out. So I just want to tell you guys that, you know, we appreciate you.
Hell yeah, man. Thank you. We appreciate you guys. Do you have MAPS aesthetic, by the way?
I don't. No.
We'll send that over to you.
Okay. Thanks, guys. So
no problem,
much.
Brother.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Right on.
All right. See you guys.
Yeah. So rule number one is trust our programs. Follow the programs, trust the programming. Rule number two, break rule number one if your body's telling you otherwise.
Yeah.
There is no other better coach than the signals that your body will tell you.
Listen to your body.
You got to listen to your body, because I don't care who, look, I don't, I, this is what you do as a trainer. When I train clients, I have a great idea of what I want to do with them. And these are people I train regularly. So I know what their bodies are doing. I will change it on the dime.
There's always a framework there, you know, to utilize, but at the same time, it changes so much, even day to day, to where you just really have to listen to what your body's telling you. And in terms of intensity, volume, all those things, you got to consider, you know, what state your body's in.
He sounds like he's doing great to me.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the stuff that he's doing, the choices that he's added. It sounds kind of like a lot, but it's not. Like, I mean, he's trying to get better at his bench. Well, the bench is inside the programs, right? So it's not like he's doing the programs plus he's doing all this extra benching or something. And the priming and fortification sessions are designed to complement all programs. He's doing the no BS six pack abs, which could be a standalone program itself, but it also can be integrated into all
of our
programs.
Yeah, you replace the core work with it.
And then the fact that he already is aware of times that when he shows up to a foundational day, there's a little sore from the previous one and he overreached, so he backs off. I think he's doing great.
He's just maximizing his MAPS usage.
Yeah. That's all. No, totally.
Our next caller is Lily from California.
Hey, Lily, how can we help you?
Hi, guys. Thank you so much for taking my call. I really appreciate it.
Of course.
So here's my question. I've been working out since 2015, actually. I started to work out because I wanted to lose some weight and I wanted to gain muscle. And that when the pandemic hit, we started wearing masks at, you know, in the gyms and stuff, and I wouldn't feel good in the gym. So I decided to take my workouts, you know, to do them at home. But since 2015, 2016 until the pandemic started, I had been in a place where we did a lot of cardio, tons and tons of cardio. Everything was every minute on the minute or as many reps as, reps as possible. So I did like all of those years of just that, you know, and kettlebell work, but everything was fast paced, really super fast paced. We would sweat a lot and that was it. Then we went to barbells. But in the barbells, we would do the same thing. It was how many reps can you do in a minute of, push-ups or press-ups or, you know, anything you name it with the barbell, we would do it, but we would do it at a super fast pace. So then somebody told me about you guys, and I started listening to you guys, and I started hearing you guys talk about how that was the wrong way to do it because you never build muscle that way. You're kind of just burning it. You're kind of just losing it anyway. So I started working out and I've got your programs, and I'm happy to say that I have gained some muscle and I have seen differences in my body, and I feel 100 times better than I did when I was doing all that cardio and just exhausting myself. And so I want to say thank you for that so much. I started doing the weight training, the resistance training. I am right now at 49 years old. And I'm 126 pounds. I'm 5'1", so I'm not, I'm pretty short. I did lose some weight with the resistance training, but it seems like I'm stuck. And I'm, you know, my question, I guess, would be, since I'm in menopause, I'm full on menopause, okay? And I do have Graves' disease, which makes my metabolism work a little overtime. So my question is, how do I, at this stage in my life, I repent that not having learned how to do resistance training earlier, because I would have loved to start it earlier. But now I'm 49 years old, and I'm afraid that I'm going to lose all of the muscle that I've been working so hard to build. I want to build muscle, but I also want to keep it, because I feel like every time I gain it, it just kind of goes down the drain. And then I'm working like uphill over that. And I'm afraid that I'm not going to be able to build strong muscles, or that my bone density with age I'm going to lack bone density. So I've been doing the performance, MAPS HITS. I did the 7-day workout that you guys put online, which was awesome. I loved it. And I love every single program that I've done with you guys. I'm hooked on it. I'm just addicted to it. And I've started recently, maybe about 2 to 3 days ago, I started MAPS Aesthetics. And so I'm wondering if that's the right program for me. And I'm right now at 1,300 calories. So I've kind of been cutting for a while, but I don't see like my fat going away.
You have plenty of information for us right now to help you out. And the what I'm excited about this question, or to help you and answer here, is the irony is the programs that you selected of ours are in the complete backwards order of what I would have you do them at. So you gravitated towards the things that are most closely like the way that you've trained in the past. You went to the 7-day a week, you did the MAPS HIT, you did the performance, and then the lightest one of volume of all the ones you did is the MAPS Aesthetic, which a perfect place for someone like you would be actually more like anabolic 2 days a week strength training and trying to build your metabolism back up. And I'm sure that's where both my partners are going to push you at, because looking at your past, your background, where your body's at currently right now, you want to go in the complete opposite, and you kind of started to go that direction. But the programs you're doing or that you've done of ours already are still more volume that I'd want you training. I'd actually want you training less frequently and less volume.
Yeah, MAPS Anabolic will blow your mind, Willie. I'm telling you, if you follow MAPS Anabolic, do the two foundational workouts, do the trigger sessions on the off days, and then you can stay active the rest of the days if you want to walk, do some stretching, that'll be fine as well. It'll blow your mind. Now, I do have a question in regards to your hyperthyroid issue and menopause. Are you working with a hormone specialist? Is there someone that you're working with that's kind of controlling this?
No, I'm kind of taking over the counter stuff that my doctor has prescribed. For the hyperthyroid, I do work with an endocrinologist, and she does have me on some meds to control that, because it's been really out of control. So she does have me on that, but on over the counter hormones, you know, progesterone.
Yeah. So hyperthyroid can be an interesting situation, right? Because it can make it almost puts your body under a bit more stress. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, normally you would burn a lot more calories. You're only at 1300 calories, which that, and combined with your hyperthyroid, tells me that you've probably beat your body up too much for too long. So MAPS Anabolic is going to be tremendous, and it might actually even balance out your thyroid a little bit. I know with people in the past that I've worked with hyperthyroid, we would put more stress on them. Their thyroid would get even worse. Now, here's the thing I'm going to recommend. Now, I don't know who you're working with. They're an expert, which is great. We found some really good hormone specialists that will do, they'll go over your current protocol and do an assessment for you. You don't have to work with them all the time, but they will assess what you're currently doing. And I've had people go there and come back and say, wow, they changed a few things and I felt a big difference. So I'm going to recommend that you go to mphormones.com and just, you know, inquire and see if an assessment would be beneficial. They'll go through your whole protocol. They'll do a blood test and see if there's something that they want to change, because that's a big deal. Mm-hmm. But as far as the workouts are concerned, MAPS Anabolic all the way. 2 days a week foundational, trigger sessions on the off days. And if you want to be active during the week, I would do walking or stretching or mobility work, but no additional workouts. And you should see significant changes in your body from doing that. So you felt a big difference from going from the crazy cardio to MAPS HIIT. Well, it'll be a bigger difference going from what you're doing now to MAPS Anabolic, because I think that's the most appropriate workout for you right now.
Yeah, the hardest thing is the mental discipline of knowing that recovery is a massive part of this entire process for you. And so to be able to take those trigger session days like in between MAPS Anabolic is going to be huge.
Cause, that's hard.
Yeah, it's tough. You don't want to go too intense with it. This is a mistake I made the first time I ran the program myself, in taking that as, well, this is a rubber band workout that I have to go crazy with. And no, this is really just about you moving and getting active recovery and really being able to, you know, get that kind of muscle pump and contraction. But this is to charge you up basically into the next workout that you're going to have, you know, preceding that. So treat your body like, like your friend. Like you want to make sure that you're recovering fully, so that way, you know, you get all the benefit of gaining muscle that you're seeking.
Yeah, yeah. And Lily, if you really just love the mental effects of exercise, and you want to do more, because you might want to, you might find yourself trigger sessions not enough.
I'm doing your programs and I'm doing them 5 days a week, and I'm doing it like with the rest periods. And I'm like, this is like an hour and 30 minutes. I'm doing them 5 days a week.
Yeah. No. So MAPS Anabolic, you're going to have way less time in the gym. But if you find on those off days you want to do something else, I think yin yoga would be amazing for you. I think yoga in general would be great for you, but you probably would gravitate towards power yoga. Don't do that. Yin yoga, the calming, slow, relaxing kind of aspect, that'll have, I think, beneficial effect for you.
You need to move. I mean, that's obvious, but make sure it's like restorative focus to that. So
yes.
Yeah, that's a good recommendation.
I would take your recommendation even farther, Lily, and tell you that I would love to see you do anabolic with two foundational days, go through the entire program, add the yoga in there once a week that Sal's talking about, and then actually do the program again. And that time is when I would allow you to go to 3 days a week. So I'd want you to go all the way through it, running the two foundational days, and then we'd run it back a second time with you running three foundational days. And then after you finish that, I would allow you to go to the MAPS Performance.
You should see some pretty significant strength gains. So that's what you'll notice. You'll go through the program, and within the first couple weeks, you're just getting stronger. Very good sign if that happens, which it probably will.
Wow, that's because I did, you guys hit it on the nail on the head, because I did start like with the fastest, strongest thing I could.
Yep.
So thank you so much for redirecting me, because now I'm sure I'm going to see changes that I'm probably not even expecting to see. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Do you have MAPS Anabolic, by the way?
No.
Well, we'll send it right over to you.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. I really appreciate everything you do for people. Thanks. No,
thank awesome. You. We appreciate
your day. Yeah.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
So it's so great, when we do stuff like, and I remember when we actually did the 7 day a week episode.
We're like, watch all the people that shouldn't do this are going to want to do this.
Yeah. And one of the things off air, we all kind of joked, is we all said that, you know, watch, we're going to do this 7 day a week, and all the people that we probably wouldn't recommend to do it would do it. And it's just, it's so hard when you've trained like this, right? Like she has, where it's circuit based class, right? So this is the Orange Theory, F45, CrossFit-esque type of high intensity, nonstop. That, and people love it because they feel amazing after. The adrenaline's through the roof, mm-hmm. and the cortisol gets released, and they feel so good afterwards, and they stick and they sweat, and so they feel like they're so productive. And then to take that person and go, oh, someone, let's get MAPS, that she literally went in the reverse order of what I would allow her to do. It's like all the biggest volume, highest intensity mm-hmm. programs we have. And there's nothing wrong with her getting to that place, but I mean, we wrote them with this idea that you start on this other end of the spectrum.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what I'm really curious about. I hope she goes to mphormones.com and gets an assessment, because you think you go to one hormone doctor that it's going to be the same as going to another one. Nothing could be further from the truth. These places have been trying to get us to work with them for so long. We said no so many times because we see what they do and it's like, oh, this doesn't, I don't think they're doing things right. Well, there's a huge difference when you go to a place where they really understand how to work with athletes. They understand how to work not just with what the numbers are supposed to say, but the symptoms.
Not just baseline, like finding your way back to the optimal.
Makes a huge
trying to optimize is what I love about RAND.
And versus, quality of life, you know?
Because a general practitioner, you know, 9 times out of 10, they're looking at the numbers and just like, oh, you're not.
You're within range.
You're not this isn't in any danger.
We'll just bring you back up.
You're not going to die anytime soon. And so there's nothing that we're concerned about as far as danger-wise, but as far as feeling good and optimizing yourself, I mean, they don't focus on that at all.
Our next caller is Pierre from Canada.
Hey, Pierre, how can we help you?
Hi, guys. So I've been training full body for the last few months, and I've seen some growth in my calves for the first time. And I've been doing full body 2-3 times a week. And I've been doing kind of trigger sessions on the off days where I would always do calf raises. But now, since for the last few months, I've also had pain in my left foot, in the ball of my foot. I'm guessing possibly metatarsalgia, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, which kind of aggravates my foot. Usually I've been able to do calf raises anyways and just kind of push through the pain, but I've never been able to properly recover, and it still kind of hurts every so often. So I don't want to have chicken legs, and I do want my calves to keep growing. So is there something I can do, an alternate to calf raises, to train my calves?
Yeah, we need to solve this issue, because if you just keep pushing through, it's going to get worse and worse. So there's a couple things you can look at. One is to look and see if you can work on the fascia on the bottom of your foot.
Yeah,
so
a lacrosse ball.
Yeah, so you can get like a lacrosse ball or a baseball, like a hard small ball of some sort, and you kind of roll it under your foot, especially in the arch of the foot, and loosen up kind of the muscles in the fascia there. So that's one thing you could do.
We sell those at mindpumpstore.com.
We have them there. Okay, yeah. Perfect. So focus on that. The second thing I would do is I would work on the articulation of your toes. Do you have MAPS Prime Pro by any chance?
I do not.
Okay, so we have some movements in there. We'll send that over to you. But like, there's toe piano would be a good one, just to get the articulation of the toes. And then I would work on the tibialis muscle, which is the muscle on the shin. So rather than doing like a where you lift your heel off the ground, what you're doing is you're standing on your heels and you're lifting the top of your foot off the ground, literally working the opposite side of your shin. So the calf is on the back, the tibialis is on the front. And oftentimes, not always, but oftentimes, pain in the foot or in the shin or tends to be an imbalance between the calf and the tibialis. So I'll start strengthening the tibialis to see if that makes a difference. And then I would lay off calf raises just for a little while, or at least not do trigger sessions for the calves to allow that to heal a little bit, because it sounds like it's already, you know, a bit of an issue.
Pierre, have you played with BFR training at all?
BFR training? Sorry.
Yeah, blood flow restriction.
Sorry, say again?
So BFR training, blood flow restriction. That's what that is.
No. Oh, okay. Sorry. No, I've never tried that before.
So this would be a great supplemental thing that I would add into what you're doing. So maybe it is, to Sal's point, that you've just got overdoing it a little bit, and one of the ways you can back off is by backing off with BFR. So BFR, and we actually have a guide on this. So when we send over the Prime Pro, Doug can send over the BFR guide for you also. And it teaches you how to do that. You use like, 80% less of the load. So there's not gonna be a lot of stress on the feet while you do it. And it's going to give your calves a massive pump, and it will stimulate some growth. So it's a great way to complement my calf training, especially if I'm noticing that I'm getting like stuff, my shins or my feet are bothering me because I'm probably hitting them so hard too often. One of the ways that I can back off and still train them is to introduce BFR training once or twice a week instead of regular loaded training.
Okay. So that sounds great.
Yeah, I'd add that. But I definitely think that the number one place is that lacrosse ball first. I've had similar I've felt this like what I think you're describing. And one of the ways that I would prime before I start my workout is doing the stuff from Prime Pro that Sal's talking about, and then doing the lacrosse ball and rolling your foot over there. And I believe we have a YouTube video on that. I think I've done the YouTube video on that one on our Mind Pump TV.
Yeah, so you want to basically work on the muscles of the foot, right? And just on getting them connected and getting them a little stronger. So like, there's toe piano is one movement in Prime Pro. short foot is another movement.
Squats,
yeah. And you just want to kind of strengthen the foot a little bit because you're working your calf. So, you know, you think of the foot and you think of it as just an extension of the calf, but the foot is covered in muscles on the bottom and you start strengthening the calf muscle. But if you have an imbalance with the muscles of the foot, then you're going to start to run into some problems. Most people get pain in the arch of their foot, but sometimes you see it in the ball of the foot as well. Mm-hmm. And it's usually just an imbalance and you need to kind of back off and strengthen the foot a little bit before you move back into calf raises.
Okay.
All right. All right, man. Great. Well, thanks for calling in.
Thank you guys. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we appreciate it. No, nobody ever thinks of that, right? They never think of the foot or even the hands having tons of muscles, right? We think the calves, maybe the forearms, but you know, if you look at an anatomy picture of the bottom of a foot, it is covered in muscle. Yeah. It's completely covered in muscle.
Well, you know, have you ever seen those sandals too that have the little prongs on them? And so that's just another way that like it shows you how much more you can stimulate the bottom of your feet and get them to respond. But then to take that to the next level, what we have in Prime Pro, we have so many different movements specifically for the foot and the ankle, you know, that just need some attention and really to devote time to that is going to help a lot.
Yeah. This screams to me like underdeveloped muscles in your feet and then overdoing your calf raises. Mm-hmm. So waking him up with a lacrosse ball. I mean, I would love to see let's see him do some like barefoot training or incorporating that. Like, I don't know what level he's at. So I wouldn't go from maybe nothing to all of a sudden.
Might be too much now.
Yeah. Right? It might be too much. So maybe start this, like he should start with some barefoot walking around and stuff, starting to incorporate with barefoot training, I think would help him out. But I think, Sal, you hit it on the head with the lacrosse ball and then Prime Pro stuff. I think what he feels right now is he's trying to hit his calves all the time like crazy, and he has weak-ass feet.
Yeah.
So that's his limiting factor. His feet are weak. He has a poor connection there. Address that, get stronger feet, and then the calves will come up. In the meantime, the BFR training is a nice segue as he backs off the heavy loading all the time. He could still keep up the frequency with the BFR while he also addresses his weak feet.
Right. Look, if you like our information, head over to mindpumpfree.com. We have a lot of guides there that can help you build muscle or burn body fat or just improve your health. Again, it's mindpumpfree.com. You can also find all of us on Instagram. So Justin is at mindpumpjustin. I'm at mindpumpsal, and Adam is at mindpumpadam.